I'm Dr Tas van Ommen of the Australian Antarctic Division, and I lead the Antarctic Climate Program. It was one of those unfortunate ends to a day that had otherwise been quite successful in the field that made me step back and ask myself, why was I there doing what I was doing? The day had gone quite well. We'd travelled a little over 100 kilometres in 12 hours driving tractors across the East Antarctic Plateau. And the plan at the end of the day was for me to drill a shallow ice core, get a short snapshot of recent climate from the 3 kilometre time machine in the layers of ice beneath my feet. The weather was coming up a little inclement though. It was minus 30 degrees and the wind picking up, blowing shards of ice against any exposed skin. So we were keen to get the job done. And as I lifted the drill for the final run of the day, I looked in despair as the business end of the drill disappeared down a hole 3 stories beneath my feet. I'd forgotten to secure a locking pin. Well, with some ingenuity from my colleagues, we got the drill back, we fished it out, and the next day we continued on our journey. But that's another story. What I really want to talk about here is why we were doing what we're doing. That's an interesting question. I mean, Antarctic is a fantastic place. Privileged to work there, it's stunningly beautiful, harsh and captivating. But that's not the reason why we're there. You see, Antarctica matters in very direct ways to all of us. The early explorers, Mawson and colleagues, understood some of this. They knew that Antarctica was important for the weather of Australia and other Southern Hemisphere continents. In the 100 years or so since, we've learned a great deal more, and we know now that Antarctica and the Southern Ocean are engine rooms of the global climate system. I'm a glaciologist and a climate scientist, and I work in a team of scientists here who are studying how Antarctica fits into the global climate system. We look back at the climate past from ice cores and other sources of evidence. We look at how things are now and how they're changing, all so that we can better predict where we're headed in the future. What I want to do now is just take you through some of the areas of study and give you a feel for what that work involves. When we think of Antarctica, of course, we think of ice. It has more than 90% of the planet's ice, and in fact, if it was all to melt, it would raise sea levels by 60 odd metres. That's not going to happen. Antarctica's had ice sheets for tens of millions of years. But we do know from the past that the waxing and waning of the Antarctic ice sheet influences sea level. Last time temperatures were 2 to 3 degrees above pre-industrial, roughly where we're heading if we overshoot the Paris targets. Sea levels were 6 to 9 metres above present. How that plays out in our warming world, what's the timing, what are the rates of change, where are the vulnerabilities, are key questions for Antarctic glaciologists. The best we can say at present is that sea level rise by the end of this century, 2100, will be between about 29 centimetres if we mitigate really hard, and 1.1 metres. That's a distressingly large range, and it overlooks the fact that that's only the likely range. The actual sea level rise could even be higher still. And of course, we care what happens beyond the year 2100. Ice is also a feature on the oceans around Antarctica. Every winter, we see a growth of the sea ice around Antarctica, the frozen skin of ocean, on average around 1 metre or so thick, more in some places and less in others. The sea ice plays a critical role in the climate system by reflecting light back to space and actually regulating the flow of heat and moisture between the ocean and the atmosphere. Sea ice is also really important for the Antarctic ecosystem, but that's a separate story. When we look at how sea ice has changed over recent decades, we see that in the Antarctic, if anything, it's increased very slightly. Unlike the Arctic, where sea ice has gone down precipitously, although in the last few years in the Antarctic, we've also seen a reversal and a starting of a decline in sea ice. We understand parts of what we're seeing here. We understand the importance of ocean currents and winds and the input of fresh water from the ice sheet and from precipitation. All of these jigsaw pieces are important, but we don't have the overall picture of where sea ice is heading. How fast is it going to change and what does that mean? The ocean around Antarctica is also important. It connects Antarctica to the rest of the planet through deep ocean currents that travel around the globe. The largest of these currents is the Antarctic Circumpolar Current, which, as the name suggests, travels all the way around Antarctica, connecting all of the ocean basins. It also actually regulates the mixing of deep ocean water and surface waters, and along with the oceans as a whole, plays a really important role buffering our climate system. In total, the oceans of the planet have soaked up something like 30% of the CO2 we've ever emitted, and more than 90% of the heat. What happens to this buffering as we go forward is a really critical question if we're going to predict the future. And we're part of international efforts to monitor the Southern Ocean, to measure the currents and the properties, and look for signs of change and ensure that we understand what's going on. So the final part of the climate machinery that we look at is the atmosphere over Antarctica and the Southern Ocean. The atmosphere, like the ocean, is a fluid component moving heat and water around the planet, connecting the tropics to Antarctica and connecting Antarctica back to mid-latitudes and Australia in particular. And the Antarctic atmosphere has changed as a result of human activity. Mostly ozone depletion, the ozone hole, but also CO2. These things have changed the temperature structure of the atmosphere above Antarctica, cooling the stratosphere and above, and actually strengthening the winds that circulate around Antarctica. These westerly winds that circulate around the Southern Ocean have not only strengthened, but they've shrunk towards the pole southward, taking with them some of the rain-bearing fronts that actually intersect Southern Australia and the other continents. We're also concerned when we talk of the atmosphere about the clouds in the Southern Ocean, which play a really important role, reflecting light back to space and controlling the amount of heat which actually reaches the ocean below. That reflectivity is critically dependent on the mix between ice and supercooled water in the clouds, and scientists are carefully modelling and understanding that mix so that we can do a better job of predicting weather and climate into the future. As we look to the future, we think also of the deeper time in the past. And so if we look at that 3 kilometre time machine I referred to earlier, we can drill ice cores that go all the way to the bottom of the ice sheet. Presently, the longest of these is a core that goes back 800,000 years. This 800,000 year ice core shows us in detail how the climate's waxed and waned over that period. We've seen warm periods like the present, interspersed with cold periods where there were ice sheets over northern North America and northern Europe. This pulsing we see in the chemical signatures from the ice core shows the climate over that time period. But we also see from the ice core something else. Trapped between the snowflakes as it gets buried, we get bubbles of past atmosphere. And when we crack open those bubbles, we can see CO2 levels. And what we see is that the CO2 over those 800,000 years looks remarkably like the temperature. Amazingly so. This shows us that temperature and CO2 on the planet are tightly coupled in the natural system. That is until we come to the recent period. If you look on the far right, you can see how the CO2 has increased since industrialisation to levels well above anything seen in the 800,000 year record. Even before we turn to our well understood physics of greenhouse gases and our climate models, the ice is telling us that things are going to be different in the future than they were in the past. You will have heard in what I've been saying a recurring theme that while we understand Antarctica and the Southern Ocean much better than we did, and we know a lot more about the climate system, there are still really important gaps in our understanding. Gaps that matter to our ability to project what's going to happen in the future. And as we look to the future, I'm reminded of the words of former White House advisor on climate, John Holdren, who said all we have is adaptation, mitigation, and suffering. As a scientist, my hope is that we can use our understanding to chart a pathway to a resilient future. Knowledge is power. Knowledge will tell us what we absolutely need to avoid. Knowledge will guide our adaptation, and knowledge will help reduce suffering. And thinking back to that cold night on the Antarctic plateau, there's the answer to my question. That's why I do what I do.